Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. My friends, greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, on this glorious Palm Sunday, a day in which we celebrate his triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem, which began a series of events leading through what we call Holy Week, and of course culminating in Easter. If you're visiting with us today, we are so thankful that you have joined your hearts and minds together with ours in celebration of God's goodness in our life, and indeed today to celebrate Jesus' entrance into the holy city. Because of the special nature of this day, there are a few things in our order of worship that will be a little different. And so first of all, I'm going to ask that you would remain seated this morning as I read for us our call to worship from John 12. And as I read this text for us, I would ask that you would allow your imaginations to go all the way back to that first Palm Sunday, and that you would experience for yourself the sights, the sounds, even the smells of that day. Hear now the word of God. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." Jesus found a young donkey and sat upon it. As it is written, "Do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey colt." I invite you to stand with us now and let us sing together to the glory of God, all glory, loud, and honor.
Thank you.
It always marvels me how many children we have as a part of the ministry of this church. I dare say there are a lot of churches in this country that would only dream and hope about the number of children we have being discipled here at First Pres. That's not to brag. That's just to thank our Lord and Savior here for his goodness and for his presence in our midst. Will you join me in prayer? Our good and gracious King, we praise and we adore you. We stand in awe of your glory and majesty, for your ways are righteous and true. With all heaven and earth, we offer you our worship, for you alone are holy and just. We declare that your love stands firm for eternity, for your loving kindness endures forever. Thank you for riding into our lives and setting us free through your death on the cross. Thank you for the drama and the impact of this day, the beginning of Holy Week, the start of your journey towards the power of the cross, the victory of the resurrection, and the rich and powerful truth that you, Lord Jesus, truly are the Redeemer King of everything. For it is in his name that we pray all of these things and so much more. Amen. This morning we have the joy and the privilege of administering the sacrament of baptism. So I'm going to ask Cameron and Magdalena Fellers to come forward with their daughter, Adelaide. While they're coming forward, I want to recognize that we have family that have come from all parts around the state of South Carolina, even Hilton Head. So you Hilton Helders, great that you abandoned the beach and you could be with us upstaters today. We have folks from Michigan as well, so thank you for coming and being a part of that. We welcome you with bright, warm skies and Yeah, we get weather here too, but maybe not quite the way you all do in Michigan. In addition to, you guys come around this way. In addition to their family here, we have another part of these two's family. This is Lee and Margaret Dixon. Lee and Margaret lead the Gathering Sunday School class here, the class in which Cameron and Magdalena are a part. Now, here's the thing. These two met as single people in this Sunday School class in 2019. And now here we are. So from time to time over the years, I would come up and visit this class, and it was the most interesting thing, I suppose. On the wall, they had this chart with all the wedding dates and all the baby birth dates coming up. And as those things would happen, they would just check them off the list for everybody to celebrate and for everybody in the class to know. Yes, we have here together one holy spiritual family, and it's a wonderful thing to celebrate today. And it's really, quite frankly, a beautiful illustration of what baptism is all about. I think so much, especially in our culture, we tend to think of baptism as kind of a me and Jesus kind of thing, right? And there is that dimension. Baptism signifies that Jesus is reaching out to Adelaide, asking her, drawing her towards a personal relationship to him. That is true. But baptism also signifies the entrance of an individual into God's covenant family and of God's promise that he will enfold us into his family. So now the family story starts all the way back in Genesis 1. Where we see that God created everything in the heavens and the earth, and then, but just a few chapters later, everything, well, it goes kind of bad. Genesis chapter 3. The family is broken. And what we see in the rest of the Bible, and even in the coming of Jesus, is God's mission to restore that one sacred covenant family. Really, that's what we're celebrating here today. Genesis 17, we also see a turn in that story of God's family, a dramatic turn when God calls Abraham and Sarah to set out and to really launch this new thing he was doing. He says, it's Genesis 17, I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your children after you for generations to come to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. And then another major turn in the story, Acts chapter 2, when Peter stood before those who were gathered at the temple that day at Pentecost, and he repeats the promise, saying, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the promised gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him. And again, that's why we're here today. Cameron and Magdalena baptism is about the eternal promises of God that span throughout the centuries, coming true in her life today. His promises to our children and to one another. And so as you present Adelaide for baptism, you in a sense are affirming that you would want her life written into God's larger story for the world. And so in acknowledgement of that, I want to ask you a series of questions. Do you acknowledge Adelaide's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you claim God's covenant promises on her behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for her salvation as you do for your own? Do you? Do you now unreservedly commit her to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before her a godly example? Do you promise this? Do you promise to pray with and for her? And will you teach her the doctrines of our holy faith? And will you strive to bring her up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord? Do you promise this? Magdalena and Cameron, by answering these questions in the affirmative, you have affirmed your faith before your church family. Now, I'm going to ask that you would all stand with them as their church family and affirm together what we believe using the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. These words will be presented for us on the video screens. First Presbyterian Church, Greenville, South Carolina. What is it that you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing. I've asked Margaret that she would present the question for you to the congregation.
Today in this sacrament, we are welcoming into our church the newest member of God's covenant family. It will be many years before Adelaide will be able to fully claim as her own the vows her parents have made on her behalf. Therefore, as covenant partners of her church family, I want to ask us to take vows before God to do all that we can to nurture her faith and to love and care for her. And so do we, as covenant partners of First Presbyterian Church, promise to guide and nurture Adelaide by word and deed with love and prayer, encouraging her to know and follow Christ and to be a faithful member of God's church. If you promise these things, please say, I do.
You may be seated. Will you join me in prayer? Great God and Father of us all, we bring before you this dear child whom you have knit together. And we ask that you would enfold her in your arms of love and grace, that you would pour out upon her heart and her mind the truth of your word, so that one day she may claim for herself the promises that are made on her behalf today. Move mightily in us so that we might fulfill the vows that we have made to show this to your child what it means to love you with all of our heart, our mind, our souls, and even our bodies. And now we ask by the mighty working of your Holy Spirit that you will set aside this water from its normal use to a holy one, that for us it would be an outward symbol of an inward reality, and that is the washing of the word and of the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit. We ask all these things in the name of Christ our Savior, who by his blood writes us into his Father's story. Amen. All right, if you'll hold this for just a moment. Okay, Dad. Let's see how it goes here now. All right. See, children like me, they don't like Pastor Richard. They squall when he... There's a story behind that. Cameron, what is your daughter's full Christian name?
Adelaide Jean Fellers.
Adelaide Jean Fellers, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May God's Spirit begin to flow through your life in a new and profound way now and forevermore. Amen. Okay, back. There we go. I'm going to ask Elder Lee if he would pray for this family now.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this family who enrich our community by their presence, and for this couple who desire to raise their daughter, Adelaide, in your ways. Strengthen them with faith when they face challenges in life, to remember what the Lord told the prophet Jeremiah, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good, to give you a future and hope." Please provide to Cameron and Magdalena wisdom and discernment in the days and years to come. Help them to focus on you as their firm foundation in the face of worldly distractions. Inspire them to take a stand, like Joshua, who reminded the Hebrew people as they prepared to enter the promised land, "Be brave, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all. Okay. Once again, good morning and welcome to this gathering for worship here at First Presbyterian, where we are equipping ourselves to transform the heart of our city and beyond with the good news of the gospel. We're so pleased that you would join your hearts and minds together with us today, whether you're here in the sanctuary or live streaming from somewhere around the world. We're thankful that you've gathered here with us to seek God's wisdom for the living of each day. As is often the case, I would like to draw your attention to a number of announcements that are included on the backside of the worship folder that you were given when you came in. So if you'll turn there with me for just a moment, I'll walk us through just a few of these. First of all, again, if you are visiting with us, we would love to connect with you further, and we have a way for you to do that. You can either text the word connect to the telephone number you see listed on the video screens or in your worship folders. It'll come up with a menu, and it'll ask you for just a few details so that we can keep in contact with you and we can share some of the things that are going on in the life of the church. You can text the word connect to the number you see, or you can go to our First Pres website, find the connect tab there, and once again, you'll see the menu. We would just love to get to know you a little bit more and let you know about some of the great things that are going around here. As I mentioned earlier, today is the beginning of the week that is commonly known as Holy Week by Christians around the world. And that is where we remember the last days of Jesus among his followers when he was tried, executed, and resurrected from the dead. To celebrate these events, we're going to have a special worship schedule. So for, first of all, March 28th, later this week, Maundy Thursday communion service will be at 7 p.m. And of course, this service will commemorate those last moments with Jesus before his betrayal and arrest. Our worship schedule for this coming Sunday, Easter, of course, is going to change just a little bit. You can see the times there. Really, the big change is the 9:15 service that's going to be added in the Worship and Arts Center. All the other events, including the Tuesday evening prayer service, are going to be canceled this week to make allowances for this special time during the week, so just be aware of that. For those of you who are considering becoming covenant partners here, our next new member weekend is going to be in early May, May 3rd through 4th. And these weekends are a great opportunity to learn more about the nature of our mission, our ministry here, what we believe, and how we go about living those beliefs. Even if you're not ready to join at that point, it's a great part of that journey of discernment. So we would invite you to that. There are details in the announcement about how to register for that event. Our Women's Spring Luncheon is going to be held on Thursday, April 4th in the Fellowship Hall. Make note about those details. And then April 14th, we're going to have our biennial Kirking of the Tartans. This was when Scottish people have fun. Once a year, don't miss it. The St. Andrew's Society of Upper South Carolina is going to be here. The pipes, the drums, all that kind of stuff, men in skirts. It's a glorious day. Just come and check it out. It's a very, very popular service on our yearly schedule every other year. In fact, it's so good we only do it every other year. As you can imagine, this is a busy time in the life of our congregation. There are other announcements for you to see. Please do review those at some point, maybe later on today, so that you can be abreast of all those wonderful things. In the call to worship that I read earlier, we saw that Jesus sent his disciples into the village in order for them to procure a donkey colt for him to ride as a part of his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. In the Matthew account, the account notes that it says that if the owners in the village asked the disciples what they're doing, taking the colt, Jesus instructed the disciples simply to say to them, "The Lord needs them." And then, of course, the owners did indeed provide for Jesus' ministry. My friends, may you and I in our own giving be as faithful as those unnamed donkey-owning villagers who gave of what they had to Jesus. Remember, the Lord needs for us to give, because more than anything, we need to be givers. I invite you now to bring your tithes and offerings into the house of the Lord.
Thank you. works like him. The river of Jordan he did cross. No man works like him. For he is King of kings. He is Lord of lords. Jesus Christ, the first and last.
Chelsea, Steve, thank you for that. That was beautiful. Deacons, please check the stained glass for cracks. Richard, I've been a mess today. I told him earlier that kirking of the tartans was the one day of the year when Scottish people have fun. Yeah. I'm just confessing my sins before they catch up to me. My friends, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Great Father in heaven, one of the agonizing things we learn from the Bible about Jesus' last week here on earth is that the same people who welcomed him with great joy as he rode into Jerusalem were the same people who demanded his life just a few days later. Lord, we fear that in so many ways we are just like those people. We lack the solid, well-thought-out principles against which to test the latest fads in our feelings. And as a result, we too switch our words and actions towards whatever direction self-interest seems to dictate in order to stay cool or popular or safe. Father, give us the courage of Jesus, who set his face steadfastly toward Jerusalem, even though he knew the fate that awaited him. Allow us to have the same courage that he had with those with whom he engaged, speaking the truth in love. And give us the brutal honesty we need to confront the sin in our own lives, sin that makes us deny Jesus in our thoughts and words and actions during the week, even as we gather to praise him on the weekends. And so, Father, would you send Jesus to ride into our lives in a way that would wipe away the old and bring in the new life that you promise? Would you send Jesus to ride into places of pain in this world where Satan still causes death and destruction? In places like Kyiv and Moscow, Gaza and Israel. Please ride into the hearts and minds of those who have grown cold to you, that your light and healing may enter in. God, as we enter into the passion of this holy week, take us once again into the dramatic events of those days, remembering how the Lord of the universe took the form of an obedient servant, even unto death on a cross. And let us never forget what he did for us, because he loved us. For that we are eternally grateful. And full of a joy that makes our hearts cry out in joy. Please join me now in response with the words of Psalm 34. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. A righteous man may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from all of them. Our hymn of preparation for the hearing of the word is entitled King of the Ages. We invite you to stand with us.
Please be seated. Please turn with me to Matthew chapter 21 this morning as we continue our series of studies in Matthew's gospel. And this morning we're reading verses 1 through 11. Brian, I was here for the announcements and I made a note in my sermon manuscript, Stuart is having too much fun. So we will talk about that tomorrow. So, there's only one pastor allowed to have fun. Now, most of you are conscious, of course, that we have been steadily working our way through Matthew's gospel, and we began that first Sunday in Advent with Matthew chapter 1 and promised we would conclude on Easter Sunday, which we will, of course, next Sunday morning. And today we come to our penultimate study, and I've added a couple of verses to read at the end of this passage, so please be patient with me as we come to Matthew 21 at verse 1. And Matthew writes these words. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me, and if anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." Amen, and we trust that God will bless to us this reading from his holy word. From time to time on a Sunday morning, I will intentionally try to make a humorous point, and my wife reassures me by rolling her eyes and sighing. And if you worship with us regularly, you will know that I am absolutely convinced that I have this wonderful, insightful, carefully honed and well-constructed sense of humor. And you, in fact, tell me that's a minority view on this, but nonetheless, I stick with it. And so this morning, I want to share with you something I got probably 2-3 years ago, and I think I used it then, but I wanted to use it again this morning because I think it will help in our study. And it begins, "A priest, a minister, and a rabbit entered a clinic to donate blood. The nurse asked the rabbit, 'What's your blood type?' 'I'm probably a type O,' said the rabbit." Now, that was much funnier in my mind as I was preparing this than it is clearly for you. But let me explain why it is genuinely funny. A priest, a minister, and a rabbi. That's the cultural joke. And of course, we follow up, went to Easter dinner. A priest, a minister, and a rabbi went to Thanksgiving, went to a restaurant, however we want to phrase it. But clearly, there's a typo at the beginning. "And entered a clinic to donate blood. And the nurse asked the rabbit, 'What is your blood type?' 'I'm probably a type O.'" And so you have a second level of humor. Thank you. Someone in the choir just got it. And some of you this evening are going to get ready for bed, and then it will drop, and oh, that's what he meant. That's how it works. That's good humor. There are multiple levels at various angles. Now, having said all of that, why am I beginning with this? Well, I'm beginning with this for this reason. That when someone else in the choir just got it, thank you, they're getting there. Why am I beginning in this ridiculous manner? Simply for this reason. That at this time of year, spring break has been with many of our children and grandchildren this past week. The clocks changed a couple of weeks ago. Plants in the garden are beginning to bloom. The evenings are a little lighter. We see children playing outside. And there's that genuine sense of a change in season. And on Sunday morning, when we gather and open up Scripture together and we come to Matthew 21, we know, of course, it's Easter Sunday, on Palm Sunday. And we know that there is lots of celebration on Palm Sunday. And our focus is often, as we saw this morning, on the children and the palms and the donkey and all of the celebrations. And of course, we know why. Because it was the Passover in ancient Israel, and we'll talk about that in a minute or two. But in the back of our minds, even though there is a new season, even though things are changing, we still know that even though it is Palm Sunday, Friday is coming. And there is in our minds a sense of anticipation and expectation. There's a sense of uneasiness, a sense that things are not quite right, even though we're coming to this, our penultimate study in Matthew's gospel. We know how it ends, but we know that Friday is coming. And as we explore this passage together, we begin with understanding that Palm Sunday ushers in Holy Week, and Holy Week is of profound importance to biblical authors. If you are familiar with or enjoy biographies, and I would have to tell you, I thoroughly enjoy biographies on historical individuals, great sports personalities, sometimes movie makers, actors, musicians, composers, pretty much anything I can get. About 10% of a biography is given over to the person's final days, but not in the Gospels. In Matthew chapter 21 focuses on the last week of Jesus, and 22 and 23 and 24 and 25 and 26 and 27 and 28. And so you have 8 chapters focused on his death, resurrection, his final week. And so we stop and we pause. And the temptation is to say, now, wait a minute. Palm Sunday feels like a typo. It feels as if it shouldn't be in there. Whenever you read a typo, it immediately captures your attention. It says, wait a minute, there's something wrong. Reread that. How does it fit in with the rest of the sentence? And the same happens with Holy Week. What is going on here? We stop and pause and consider and say, wait a minute, what's happening here? And to further that sense of uneasiness, that sense of there's something else happening. Remember what was said 2 weeks ago in chapter 16, when Jesus says to Peter, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples, he must go up to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. And Peter was so impacted by those words, he became angry and he said, Lord, that will never happen to you. It's a typo. It's a mistake. This will never happen. And then in chapter 20, verses 17 and 19, now as Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and teachers of the law. And they will condemn him to death and will turn him over to the Gentiles and to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and on the third day he will be raised to life. And all of this runs through our minds at this time of year, and we begin to have that sense of there is so many things happening here. What is going on? There's that mounting sense of dread. And the other dynamic for us to remember, of course, is this, that in verse 4 of the passage we read this, and this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet. In other words, Matthew is telling us that all of the Old Testament, from Genesis all the way through to Malachi, pointed towards Jerusalem. That the eternal purposes and decrees of God were heading in this direction. Now, for some of us on a Palm Sunday morning, naturally, we get caught up with the children. We get caught up with the waving of the palms. It's cute, and we enjoy it. There's a note of celebration, and we should. And then we get caught up focused on the donkey and the road through the Kidron Valley down toward just outside Jerusalem and then up into Jerusalem itself. And we get caught up in all of these things. And yet, when Matthew says, and this took place to fulfill, he's telling us, hold on, stand back. There is so much more going on here than you can see. Because Matthew knows that from Genesis all the way through, as we said earlier, empires rise and fall, kings rise and fall, nations rise and then cease to exist. But the one constant thread throughout it all is God heading us and directing us towards Jerusalem, towards Golgotha, because Friday is coming. And in the midst of all of this, please remember the significance of Palm Sunday, because it ushers in Holy Week. That's the point. By the end of this week, Jesus will, of course, be betrayed, arrested, abused, abandoned. As he comes into Jerusalem that morning, Brian mentioned it earlier, he comes on a donkey, on the foal of a donkey. In the ancient Near East, in antiquity, whenever someone of importance and significance, a great general, came into a city like Jerusalem, he would arrive on a large white charger surrounded by military units, and they would move together parading through the city. And just as he was born in a stable, here he comes riding on a donkey. Talk of humility. It was right there. Luke's gospel tells us this. Way back in Luke chapter 9, he said, Luke recalls, he set his face resolutely for Jerusalem. And as you read the gospels, you begin to get the sense that Jesus did not end up on a cross on Friday because Pilate was a weak leader. He wasn't there because of the jealousy of Judas. He wasn't there because of Peter's denial. All of these incidents colored the picture, but the primary purpose of him being there was for the sin of humanity. He was bringing salvation to us. That's what was going on. It wasn't a typo. It wasn't an accident. It wasn't something that wasn't supposed to happen. But in fact, as you read the gospel, he himself is overseeing, directing, and leading towards Jerusalem. And all of that unfolds in Matthew's gospel. And then, of course, we read these wonderful words. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this? Who is this?" And remember Matthew chapter 1? All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child, will give birth to a son, and we will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Last Sunday morning in chapter 16, when Jesus says to the disciples, "Who do you say I am?" Once again, his identity was first and foremost. It played a central part. And Peter says what? "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." His identity was clear. Two chapters earlier in Matthew chapter 14, when he walked on water and stopped the storm in the Sea of Galilee, climbed back in the boat, instinctively, it was their natural desires. The disciples look at him and say, "What? Truly, you are the Son of God." He could control nature itself. "Truly, you are the Son of God." And it's all building, building, building towards Jerusalem. All this took place to fulfill. It was no typo. And as the passage develops, what happens? Verse 12, as Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling, he overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "my house will be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." What is going on? What is going on is this: that the population of Jerusalem moved, and I should have checked this out, so please forgive me, I didn't check it this week, from around 450,000, 500,000 to 1.1 or 1.2 million, because it was the Passover. People from around the entirety of the Mediterranean basin, North Africa and Egypt in the south, moving up towards Jerusalem to celebrate the emancipation and the liberation of the people of Israel. Others would come from Greece and Italy and Europe in the north, from Syria and from Syria, modern-day Turkey, heading south towards Jerusalem to celebrate all that God had done in the past and allowing them to establish themselves as an independent nation. He was faithful to his children decade after decade, and they were coming in huge numbers. And as they arrived, they would be looking forward and talking about celebrating in the temple. But they didn't bring with them a calf, a goat, a lamb. They would simply buy it there. And as you walked into the temple forecourts, the outer court of the Gentiles was the same size as 35 football fields. Imagine the size of that. And there were animals in cages everywhere. And there were, tax booths set up. So you would take your coin from North Africa, from Cyrene, and you would go to the temple, and your coin probably had an image of Caesar, which was no good in the temple. He was considered to be an idol, and so they would exchange their money and be given a Jewish shekel, and they could then pay their temple tax and buy an animal to sacrifice. And of course, you had that strange, bizarre mix of commercialism along with corruption and greed, and folks exchanging money could charge whatever they liked. And if you didn't like it, you could go two booths down, and the chances are they would charge you more. And Jesus looks at all of this, knowing it was there, and his frustration comes out, and he says, this is supposed to be a place of prayer. This is a place where pilgrims come to quietly bow in the presence of Almighty God, to worship Him and give thanks for His goodness and His love and His grace. And you have turned it into a den of robbers. You have been here so long, you can no longer determine the stench. You can no longer determine the corruption that's taking place here. Shame on you. This is appalling. What on earth are you doing? And they are so steeped in it, they no longer see it. And Jesus becomes frustrated and in righteous indignation takes off his belt, twists it with others, turns it into a whip, tips over tables and runs them out of the temple. And people think that's odd. They think it's odd that in that very place where the temporal and the eternal, where the secular and the sacred meet, that he wants to jealously guard it as a sacred space, and he drives them out. It's not a typo, it's not an accident, it's not something added by Matthew just for the sake of it. He's pointing to who this is and why he has come. And he's come to bring salvation and intimacy with God. He's no interest in the shallow or the superficial or the rote or the routine. He wants to radically change it. And I would also add this, that it makes us seriously uncomfortable again. Why? Because we like Jesus, meek and mild. We like him in the Sermon on the Mount when he says, blessed are the humble, for they are sons of God. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will find comfort. We like him as gentle Jesus, meek and mild. But when he is serious about cleansing the temple, and then he takes it to the next level for us, and he begins to cleanse the temple in our own hearts. He begins to challenge our thought process. He begins to challenge our daily behaviors. He begins to challenge how we interact between husband and wife, father and son, mother and daughter, colleagues at work. He begins to say, live out your faith. That's why it's Holy Week. It's not Indifferent Week. It's not Apathy Week. It's Holy Week. He calls us to that sacred space to go deeper, and he is not interested in the superficial or the cosmetic. He's interested in radically changing us from the inside out to draw closer to him and understand and be overwhelmed once again by his love and his grace. That's what's going on here. Now, here's some points for you to take home this morning. Because it's one thing to say, okay, Richard, I understand what you're saying. I understand the significance of Holy Week. I think I get it. But give me something to take away. Well, here it comes. When you're serious about your faith and your relationship with him, Jesus introduces us to sins in our own lives which we need to confront. And I would have to tell you, I do not want him to ever confront the sin in my life when you can see that take place. Because there's sins in my life I am deeply ashamed of. There's sins in my life that I have become comfortable with. Thought process, patterns, habits, behavior that need to change, and he confronts me with them. And this Holy Week is a good week to do that. Secondly, he highlights for us the patterns of behavior we need to break. Let me become specific. Are we in this day and age watching things on our phones or on a laptop screen or at home that would embarrass our parents? And yet we just sit there and look at it and think it's okay? Have we become so immune to it? Is it time for him to turn over the temple tables in our lives? Absolutely. Painful, hurtful. Does it sting? Yes. But it's always healthy. And thirdly, he brings to us insights into who we really are that we didn't have before. And often, at least speaking out of my own experience, is that he'll hold me close and he'll reassure me and he'll say, you're mine and you're loved by me with an everlasting love, and I will not walk away from you, and I will not abandon you, and I will not give up on you. And he utterly insists on loving his children. That's a whole new insight. And you say, wait a minute, you love me even though I... He says, yes. You love me even though I... Absolutely. You love me even though I don't... Yes. That's his love. That's why it's Holy Week. He changes and transforms and refreshes and renews. He never loves us to enable us to remain the same. He loves us and transforms us in order that we might be more like him and understand the wonder of the grace of God. And finally, we discover a depth of relationship with God that we never knew existed. That's what's going on. That's why it's Holy Week. That's why it's transformative. That's why he's radical. And there is nothing else like it. It's no typo. It was always part of his plan. And he loves us because he loves us, because he loves us, because he loves us. Palm Sunday. Friday's coming. But so is Easter. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you this morning for the immensity of your love. We freely confess we will never be able to get over it all. And so we ask that as we enter into this Holy Week, may we be the folks who mentally, psychologically, emotionally are able to say, Hosanna to the Son of David in our heart and mind and soul, and to live for you this week. Father, change us. Transform us. Cleanse us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is one we have sung for several decades. It's a spectacular hymn, certainly one of my favorites. I believe it's one of yours as well. Let's stand and sing, "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name." Watching on our live stream broadcast, both here in the United States and overseas, thank you for being with us this morning, and we very much look forward to welcoming you on Easter Sunday morning. For those here live in the sanctuary, a warm thanks to our baptismal family this morning. So good to have you with us this morning. And any visitors who are with us, I do trust and pray you will leave this morning encouraged in your faith. However, if you're here this morning and struggling and you need someone to talk with you and pray with you, our elder prayer team will be right here in the sanctuary steps and glad to pray with you. Let's pray together. And now may the blessing of God the Father, the Almighty, may the eternal love of Christ the Son, and the peace and the transforming presence of God the Holy Spirit rest upon each one of us, both now and always. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you for joining us this morning at First Presbyterian Church of Greenville. We hope you have a blessed week, and please join us again next Sunday.
Hailed is the Savior, he entered Jerusalem. The humanity of God, tempted and tried. Crucified by the ones he came to save. Risen and victorious, he reigns forever. Join us in celebrating Holy Week at First Presbyterian Church of Greenville.